tells us in no uncertain manner that we have to engage at all times in our lives our human frailty, and more importantly, our human interaction with each other. Always, in fact, luxuriating in every single moment of our life, that we hold on to those who are dear to us and keep them safe and secure. The Office of the President is committed to institutional transparency, accountability, and integrity. Throughout the financial year, officers of the Auditor General's Department will assess and invariably guide the accounting officers of the Office of the President to ensure that officers properly do their job in accordance with financial and procurement rules and regulations. It is not uncommon that when there are doubts with regard to the use of a particular vote, for example, that the accounting officers of the Office of the President consult with the Director of Budgets, all with a view to ensuring that the processes and regulations, financial and otherwise, are adhered to. I also have certain constitutional responsibilities and duties, and I'm aware that these must be carried out to the rule and spirit of the Constitution, laws, and conventions. As President, I have always acted within my constitutional remit and will continue to do so. This is not to say that there are sometimes great areas of engagement with the other arms of the executive. And this is not uncommon in burgeoning democracies. However, I am fully aware that any power an individual has must always be exercised with responsibility, a sense of fairness, transparency, integrity, and respect. This has been my mantra, and I've never wavered from it, from that belief. And I always practice that belief in real terms. I am about proactivity. And I am an important crew member on the ship of state. I cannot see things going wrong and remain quiet. There are currents in the river, and I cannot be indifferent to its dangers, the danger to the swimmer who is on the way. I am a simple man with a big heart and an exceptional job, and I'm a practicing believer in service leadership. Many issues have been raised in the public domain in the last 2 weeks. One, of course, is dealing with the importation of wine by the Office of the President. Of course, it has generated old mass, nice old mass, because I recall, in fact, not too long ago when I played a lot of old mass, that I remember in Faizabad winning a old mass competition when I had a table tennis racket, lawn tennis racket, badminton racket all over me, and my sign was too much racket in place. By law and convention, the Office of the President is required to host and or provide service and other support to state diplomatic and official functions and ceremonies, national and international events, and the patronages under the purview of us, the President and the Supreme of Carmona. In many instances, as host to these events, Her Excellency and I foot the bill from the relevant vote under the presidential budget. Such events must contain standards consistent with international protocols and practices. It is accepted international protocol and convention to serve quality food, quality beverages, including wines and champagne, as appropriate, among other cuisine and beverages and its functions. And they must be held at appropriate venues. On my assuming office in March 2013, I determined, and if you check your records, you will realize I stated that very matter-of-factly, that the prevailing economic downturn required fiscal and economic measures to control the very high cost of functions under the aegis of the Office of the President. Her Excellency and I recognized that the price of wine, champagne, and catered cuisine was simply too high. Therefore, the proactive decision was to break with the tradition of the past and remove champagne from beverages offered to guests at these functions, and to cut down significantly on the catering out at these functions. Given the high local and regional market prices for quality wines, the Office of the President sourced comparable quality wines, white wine, red wine, and sparkling wine, at exceptionally reasonable prices from a well-respected vineyard in Italy. The cost of these quality wines, bought in 2014 by the Office of the President, was erroneously stated in the press as 1 million. The cost of these quality imported wines amounted to 1,483,638.40. The purchase was made in 3 vouchers payments on the following dates. On the 25th of November 2014, 793,472.40. On the 1st of May 2015, $347,484. On the 27th of July 2015, $342,682. As a result of this cost-effective purchase, the Office of the President has not made any additional purchases of quality wines since late 2014, 2015, 2016, and we anticipate even 2017, notwithstanding the increased number of events hosted and paid for by Your Excellencies under the presidential budget. The purchase of these quality wines, the red wine, the white wines, and the sparkling wine, has been conducted with the requisite transparency, due diligence, and in keeping with proper procurement practices as advised. This commercial decision has resulted in substantial savings to the Office of the President and by extension the taxpayer. By removing champagne alone, the Office of the President has cut alcohol expenses by some $600,000 a year. Additionally, the importation of these specialized high-quality wines has also cut significantly the rest of the alcohol budget. Your Excellency and I did not stop there. The caterers that provided services to the Office of the President in the past were simply too high. As a result, at the President's household, we have well-trained cooks as part of the presidential retinue, and we have therefore cut down by some 80% using caterers and restaurateurs at function. The well-trained cooks have not only enhanced the quality of foods served, much to the stated appreciation of our stakeholders. But it gives the trained cooks the opportunity to showcase their culinary skills and dynamism that has effectively raised the persona of presidential cuisine. Contrary to false and incorrect media reports, neither Ms. Prima Nui, former private secretary to the president, nor Mr. Antonio Piccolo purchased or imported quality wines on behalf of the office of the president. Additionally, contrary to false media reports, Italian Import Export Limited, a registered local company, and its directors did not purchase or import any wine on behalf of the office of the president. The office of the president utilized a well-established registered local company to be the agent who facilitated the purchase and importation of such quality wines. Further, these quality wines imported were neither bottled nor labeled in Trinidad and Tobago. For the record, Mrs. Prima Nui was my private secretary not a few months after, but from inception. She's of tertiary education and she's fluent in Spanish, Italian, and German. Miss Liverpool, again I have to correct this anomaly, is not my accounting officer. Mr. Serret is, and Fleet Williams is substantive fleet mechanic. Adverse comments on all of these persons may well have gone beyond the threshold of fair comment. The legitimate use of the presidential press. The National Coat of Arms is not the presidential press, and the presidential press is not the coat of arms. Listen quietly. The National Coat of Arms is not the presidential crest, and the presidential crest is not the coat of arms. The National Coat of Arms is governed by the government of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago under the purview of the National Emblems Committee Regulations, Chapter 1904, Act Number 14 of 1967. Which fall under the Ministry of National Security. Its copyright is vested in the state of Trinidad and Tobago. The second and last Governor General of the Trinidad and Tobago, Sir Ellis Clark, on the 27th of July 1976, issued the proclamation placing the new constitution into effect and declaring Trinidad and Tobago a republic as of Sunday, August the 1st, 1976. In the circumstances, the Governor General's personal standard was lowered and a new presidential standard bearing and incorporating the coat of arms of Trinidad and Tobago surrounded by a laurel wreath in gold was hoisted, the presidential crest. Our Republican Constitution gave birth to the presidential crest. The emblem became the official seal crest of the President of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago and is exclusive to the head of state and the office of the President in the performance of his functions and administrative duties. It is the symbol of the President and the office he holds. The crest seal of the President of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago is therefore not to be confused with the National Coat of Arms. They are separate and apart. One is regulated by the government with respect to its usage and other recipients. And the other, represents the symbol of the office of the head of state. And the other regulated by the President as his symbol as head of state. The copyright of the seal of the President is vested in the office of the President by virtue of his powers enshrined in Chapter 3 of the Constitution of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. The President is Chancellor of the Orders of Trinidad and Tobago and Chief Custodian of his crest and seal. The crest and seal of the Office of the President of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago can and has been used on all stationary cutlery and crockery, napkins, silverware, vehicles, and other diverse things. Traditionally, the Crown agents in London catered for and provided all of these requirements for the colonial governors and the governors general of Trinidad and Tobago. While the attainment of Republican, with the attainment of Republican status in 1976, all items that had the previous royal cipher of Queen Elizabeth II had to be replaced with the crest and the seal of the President of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. These items of bone chinaware, previously supplied by Royal Worcester in the United Kingdom and the President's House, has items of bone china still in use from 1979 in the Mountbatten pattern. Later on, chinaware from William Edwards in England were ordered and are also currently in use. It is important to note that the underside of this bone china service permanently imprints the President House, the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, fine bone china, and the presidential crest is imprinted thereon. Likewise, in a similar manner, as in the past, the Honorable Prime Minister, heads of foreign missions abroad, all used the national coat of arms on their China service at their official residence. The Trinidad and Tobago Defense Force used their logo on all of their China and continued. As is customary and traditional, one of the duties of this head of state is to entertain. And His Excellency the President must hold banquets as well as official state and diplomatic dinners. The use of the crest and the seal of the head of state on bottles of wine or spirits to be served at official functions is not unique to the Republic of Trinidad. In the United Kingdom, there are whiskies named the House of Lords and the House of Commons, with the seal of the UK Parliament. And these are presented by members of both houses as official gifts in the United States at the White House. An exclusive beer is brewed for the President and his guests. In relation to the positives of having a branded use of the presidential wine, the following ought to be noted. One, there is no corporate branding or advertisement on the wine bottles of a supplier or of the name on the product. The wine is used strictly for official functions at the Office of the President of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, held by the Excellencies. The branded quality wines with the crest can be monitored and audited so as to prevent theft and disappearance. The unit cost, and I repeat, the unit cost of these quality wines with the personalized labor costs significantly less than what was supplied by previous suppliers. The product cannot be commercially sold, exchanged, or be available to the public outside of state functions and events. The product, the wine, is not personal to the president, but is exclusive to the office of the president. In relation to the presidential crest seal, the National Emblem Act does not apply to the crest seal of the Office of the President. It is mentioned nowhere in the Act. The office of the President does not have to apply to any authority or the Minister of National Security for permission to use the presidential crest or seal. These quality wines of the office of the President have never been sold, exchanged, or given as a gift. Anyone found in possession of a full bottle of the wine with a presidential crest or seal can be charged with being in unlawful possession of stolen goods. In conclusion, on this issue, the issue of the replica of seal and crest of the president on bottles of wine of functions and events does not infringe or violate any law of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. There is nothing illegal in its use. The presidential crest seal is for the exclusive use of the office of the president. The presidential seal is a symbol of the constitutional and conventional authority vested in the president as a result of the Republican Constitution. All persons, without exception, are offered those wines at all presidential functions and special events. I now turn to the Auditor General's report of financial matters. The Auditor General's report for the financial year 2015 never stated or implied that the office of the president has stolen any money, misused any money, misappropriated any money, nor has he stated that the office of the president has overspent or misused monies within its budget. The president and or of the office of the president neither stole, misused, abused, nor misappropriated any public funds, including the sum of $2.8 million. The Auditor General never accused the Office of the President of buying $2 million in jewelry, and this particular allegation was debunked and rejected by the Office of the Auditor General when it was contacted before the story broke. When a particular reporter contacted the Office of the Auditor General and was provided an explanation and information that the allegations about the misuse and misappropriation of said $2 million, it was stated to that reporter it was simply false and unsupported. When in fact the story ran that night, there was no mention made of that revelation. For the sake of clarification, it is to be noted that the Auditor General's report for the financial year 2015, dated April 29, 2016, made absolutely no mention whatsoever of missing or misspent money by the Office of the President in the sum of $2.8 million. Rather, the report references an administrative error in the classification of the money spent and states that the said money was classified under a particular vote or heading when it ought to have been so listed and classified under another related vote and heading. A newspaper report stated that there was a 2.8 million query about overspending at the president's house, suggesting or implying that money was misspent. This is a total fabrication. The sum referred to by the Auditor General was correctly stated not as $2.8 million, but as $2,685,236. The Auditor General's report stated that the $2.6 million was incorrectly classified and paid under the wrong vote. The media keeps repeating that it's the sum of 2.8 million. Let me give you some examples of wrong classification, so that in fact for one moment you do not feel that I am trying in any way to in fact divert attention from the focus of attention. For example, there are two votes that line up similarly in the presidential budget, vote 19 and vote 66. Vote 19 is for official entertainment of the office of the president. And vote 66 is for hosting of conferences, seminars, and other functions. So that items and goods paid under vote 19 should have been paid under vote 66, and vice versa. It is simply a matter of how the accounting department interpreted items and goods received in the context of the vote. The office of the president receives, by far, the lowest annual budgetary allocation among all state institutions in Trinidad today. Ours is a case of double digits. We are not into treble digits. This allocation pays for all expenses, including the salaries of the presidential staff and public servants. In relation to that query, incorrect classification is not exclusive to this office in the Auditor General report for the financial year 2015. And it may be worth your while to not peruse, but have a serious look at what is in the auditor's report, line by line. In any event, incorrect classification is a general problem across the board. And you would come across in the Auditor General's report many instances of incorrect classifications by those entities falling under the accounting jurisdiction of the Auditor General. Incorrect classification does not mean that the money has been misused, spent illegally, or stolen in any government or public department. For example, going back to this 2.6 million, did anyone check to see, for example, that about that 2.6 million, $1,862,600 of that said 2.6 million, or if you are interested in statistics, 70% went in the payment of salaries legitimately, of persons legitimately employed at the office of the president. But again, it was classified as coming out from the wrong vote. As we say in Trinidad, is somebody trying to get on the office of the president? Reference was made to a public accounts committee hearing dated June 8, 2016, where the Deputy Auditor General had inadvertently, and I repeat, inadvertently stated that the Auditor General was not in receipt of a response to a memo sent on April 16, 2016. When the Office of the President sent its response to the Auditor General Department, they had already gone to press because I was out of the country and I had applied for an extension. Notwithstanding, the Office of the President responded comprehensively to every single query on all queried matters on April 29, 2016. A further query was made at the Public Accounts Committee on items costing $300,000, $442.92. sense, which were bought by the OTP, and not entered in the inventory register. I wish to emphasize that the inventory register is not the only one at the office of the president. There exists an inventory register for the president's cottage, household, and the interim audit team from the Auditor General's Department was made aware of its existence, and it was made available to them. All these items were purchased for our many official and state functions, to name a few: the annual ambassadors and heads of mission diplomatic dinner, the annual national awards, and also for events taking place both in Trinidad and in Tobago. A response dated 29 April 2016 to the management letter was dispatched to the Auditor General, and in that response, and I'm quoting here from a confidential document because I'm a stickler for confidentiality, the Auditor General was made aware that these items are available in the cottage and arrangements can be made for their viewing and physical verification. They, however, did not take up the offer. Serious allegations, very unfounded, almost bordering on the mischievous, were laid at the doorstep of the Office of the President concerning the use of this allocated budget. Since my tenure began in March 2015, the President's budgetary allocation for that year was $22,849,380. In 2014, the allocation was $34,503,520. In 2015, it was $37,676,070. And in 2016, $25,867,510. The actual expenditure when I assumed office in 2013 was $20,498,611. In 2013, that resulted in actual savings of $2,350,769. In 2014, the actual expenditure was $25,028,954. This has resulted in savings of $9,540,566. In 2015, the expenditure was $24,957,314, resulting, ladies and gentlemen, in a savings of $12,718,756 that were never utilized and sent and was sent back to the Treasury. We are still in 2016. We saved taxpayers' money in 2013, 2014, and 2015, and we are looking good in 2016. This is against a backdrop where Her Excellency and I are having at least three times the amount of official state events, functions, and patronages that were previously held. The result of many initiatives that both Her Excellency and I have taken on board actively and personally. By our fiscal policies, notwithstanding the inflationary crisis occurring between 2013 and 2016, we have been able to keep within our budget, underutilize our budget, and have not misspent or misappropriated or misused the taxpayers' money, because we are aware that the office of the president does not belong to my wife and I, but to the people of Trinidad and Tobago. Ours is an ostensible, prudent stewardship of the public purse, and the rest of the public service may do well in trying to emulate what we have done, what we feel proud of, and what we shall continue to do. It may assist the citizens of this country if the independent, non-political, free and fair press that we certainly must have in Trinidad and Tobago peruse every line of the Auditor General's financial report for the year 2015 to determine where money is missing, misspent, vouchers and checks cannot be found, another vast array of financial queries. Additional cost. If this president was in possession of an official residence, I would have been well pleased to save the taxpayer even more money. While resident in that 50-year-old compound called Flagstaff, my wife and I were not in possession of an area to host state, diplomatic, national or international events between March 2013 and May 2015. During that said period, the presidential cottage and St. Barnes were under repair and refurbishment, and it was unsafe to hold any functions on the president's grounds given the structural concerns with respect to interior, the president's house, which had collapsed in part. This situation has not changed. And since then, the office of the president has had to go cap in hand to find places to host the aforementioned events, which has resulted in great rental costs for various localities and preparation thereof. For example, the Queen's Hall management has been kind to make available Queen's Hall free of charge to hold such events when Queen's Hall is available for free. And this is becoming a challenge because of commercial and artistic demands of its stakeholders. For example, hosting the national awards at Queen's Hall and swearing in a new government can easily cost a lot in the context of putting down the infrastructure and other prudent facilities, on the average hundreds of thousands of dollars. Because, for example, of our historical institutional marginalization, we have a depleted fleet of vehicles. Some of our vehicles have not been changed for 7 to 12 years, resulting quite often in the rental of vehicles when they break down. All these monies for rentals, for places, vehicles and equipment come out of the double-digit presidential budget. There has been a query in the public domain as to why auditors from the Auditor General's Department who audit our accounts are the same auditors for the Integrity Commission. Now, this unsatisfactory and burdensome arrangement for our accounting unit is the result of a cabinet minute number 1114, dated the 26th of May, 1988, that accounting services for the Secretariat of the Integrity Commission be provided by the accounting unit of the Office of the President. The accounting unit of the Office of the President, therefore, has been horribly stretched, and there has been a type of institutional indifference to the overburdened accounting unit. It is simply unfair for a small accounting unit to shoulder the burden of the accounting unit of the burden to shoulder the burden of the accounting of the Integrity Commission, an organization larger in numbers than the Office of the President. I have raised this concern with the relevant authorities for some time. The composition of staff in the Integrity Commission has increased to over 60% in the last few years, much larger, I'm told, than the presidential staff. Our accounting staff comprise of 5 persons, 1 accountant, 2 accounting assistants, a clerk 2 and a clerk 1, and the presidential accounting and auditing staff must check all accounting and auditing work for the Integrity Commission and print their checks for salaries, for contract checks, and post-dated checks. This has presented undue and unwholesome burden on our accounting staff and, by extension, the accounting and auditing system in the office. We simply have inadequate staff to properly manage the required financial and auditing checks and balances as efficiently as we would like to. It gets worse when, for example, we are coming to the end of a financial year. My workers are working here until midnight for the last week to deal with the problem. But who is this? We simply have inadequate staff to properly manage the required financial and auditing checks and balances as efficiently as we would like to. The type of accounting oversight and the accounting unit wishes to engage cannot be undertaken comprehensively and professionally with this very small complement of staff. In 2012, the Office of the President approached the Comptroller of Accounts recommending the removal of the Integrity Commission accounting and auditing functions, since its staff had expanded much more than the staff of the Office of the President, placing undue strain on the capacity of the accounting staff to address its primary accounting responsibilities to the Office of the President. The Comptroller of Accounts was a bit indifferent to our inadequate accounting staff, and more so, the constitutional independence of the Integrity Commission. The Comptroller of Accounts, after examining our accounting structure, together with the Public Management Consulting Division, concluded that this office should continue the accounting and auditing work for the Integrity Commission. Our hands are tied. The Office of the President, however, reiterates that the constitutional remit and mandate of the Integrity Commission implicitly require full independent accounting and auditing autonomy. Housing allowance. The public may be asked, what really is an official residence for the President? Any president of the Republic of Trinidad. In my humble view, a senior attorney, Mr. Gregory Delzin, in the Guardian newspaper of Tuesday, the 11th of November, 2014, outlined in real terms what constitutes the suitable alternative accommodation equivalent to the official residence of the president when the president's house is not available. And I quote, he states, the situation would demand that one ask several questions, such as whether the president could hold various types of functions at Flagstaff, as he would have at President's House. Can he host world leaders there? Can he have state banquets there? Can he carry out functions of his office there that the president's house would demand apart from administrative issues? Can he hold cocktail parties or receptions at Flagstaff or hold scholarship winners? He went on, the allowance is not the president's call. It is the terms and conditions contained in the SRC report. And of course, SRC is of course the Salaries Review Commission report, as laid in Parliament. And that informs, guides the chief personnel officer as to what the office holder is entitled to or not. On election to the office of the president, Senior Superintendent Gary Gould, head of special branch, advised me that he had some security concerns with my continuing to live in my rented apartment in a cul-de-sac in Flagstaff whilst awaiting the repair and refurbishment of the president's cottage. I had been living there over 15 years. It was common knowledge that the official residence, the president's house, had essentially collapsed and was uninhabitable. The special branch is responsible for the close body protection of the president of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago and his family, among many other officials. He stated in so many words, and of course I do recall, that persons had been robbed, shot, and murdered on Maravar Road, right outside the walls of Flagstaff that surrounded the cul-de-sac. Senior Superintendent Gould suggested that my family and I, that is my wife, my 10-year-old daughter, and 12-year-old son, occupy a more secure single townhouse, one that was occupied by the former Commissioner of Police, Mr. Gibbs. We were informed by the relevant authorities that it would take 3 to 4 months to refurbish the president's cottage. We had expressed the desire to remain in our rented apartment with larger rooms, but the security concerns expressed by Senior Superintendent Gould and the potential inconvenience to our neighbors prevailed, and we decided to go to that house. We ended up staying in that townhouse, in that 50-year-old compound, from March 2013 to the end of May 2015. The 3 to 4 months ballooned into 2 years and 2 months. We were told that the presidential cottage was in need of extensive repair and refurbishment due to institutional neglect, that seemingly the fourth president, Professor Richards, had no control over. The refurbishment of the pool at the president's cottage created a peculiar problem. The pool had been previously been filled with sand and tiled over. I was informed that when the area was unearthed, the pipes of the pool were so rusted to the extent that it required major works. The condition in Flagstaff was highly unsatisfactory. We were in a dilemma of sorts. We were informed that to provide alternative suitable housing in keeping with the Salaries Reviews Commission firm recommendation, it would have resulted in a monthly rental of $300,000 a month for the president, his family, household staff, special branch, and ADCA. I wish you all to recall that during the tenure of that phenomenal world leader, President N.A.R. Robinson, who of course was president of Trinidad and Tobago at the time, that his aide-de-camp lived close by to effectively engage his functions. The Salaries Reviews Commission report, by way of the Minister of Finance and the Economy Circular No. 2 of 2014, which deals with the remuneration arrangement for the President of Toronto, who states as follows. And I quote, remuneration arrangements for holders of public officers within the purview of the Salaries Review Commission. Housing. And I quote, this is what the President is entitled to. This line was never appreciated by anyone, and I would like you all to revisit it incisively. And I quote, the President of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, whoever he is entitled to official residences fully furnished and maintained by the state with the necessary complement of household staff. That is number one. The President is also entitled, where the official residence is not available for use by the President and suitable alternative accommodation is not provided, an allowance of $28,000 per month. What is apparent and what has been foisted on the population is that if the President is given a furnished state house, he cannot be given a housing allowance. This interpretation is one that correctly obtains in the general public service. However, it is totally different as it relates to the President. If the official residence is not available, the state must find suitable alternative accommodation that must be on par with the official residence, which is the President's house, not even the President's cottage. Once that cannot be provided, the Salaries Reviews Commission, and not the President, mandates that the President be paid the said monthly allowance. Bearing that in mind, an interdisciplinary design consultant and advisory firm was commissioned to give an assessment of the suitability of the Flagstaff residence as an alternative suitable accommodation for a President. The firm's professional report found it substandard and recommended that an appropriate home of the required ambassadorial quality will result in the taxpayer paying approximately $17,000 a month. And this does not take into consideration the opine. The fully furnished official residences that auxiliary, military and household staff require. Given the exorbitant cost of intended rentals for my family and the presidential staff, we simply decided to ride it out and stay at Flagstaff, putting along the authorities to complete the cottage. Our humility became our burden. Whenever it rained, the drawing room was flooded, the dining room leaked. There were leaks in the 15 by 15 master bedroom for over a year. There was no generator. So when electricity went, we used candles until I personally bought emergency lights out of my pocket. The water tanks and pump did not properly function. It fell on deaf ears. So I bought a $1,000 gallon tank again out of my own pocket. The bathroom pipes burst about 8 times, flooding the master bedroom. And finally, the entire kitchen flooring collapsed. And we simply put a piece of hard carpet over it because the authorities suggested that it would take 3 weeks to repair the floor because the tiles in the kitchen and the entire drawing room had become wobbly and unstable. It was suggested that my family and I stay at Hyattwood Hotel for 3 weeks while they repaired the place. We never took up that offer because it was simply going to be too expensive, given the fact that special grants and the presidential staff and retinue would have to be put up also in Hyatt. We were trying our best. We were trying our best to resolve things quietly because we never felt that the office of the president should be subject or be the subject of public ridicule. It turned out that we personally became the object of ridicule by some. And we were lied upon viciously. The entire professional report of the consultant firm was made available to the Auditor General's Department so that it can be part of its records. And posterity. The chairman and members of the Salary Bureau Commission, through its secretary, the chief postal officer, decided in the context of what can only be deemed deplorable conditions that the president and his family were granted the housing allowance. The Salaries Review Commission that granted the housing allowance of this president, that Salaries Review Commission was not appointed by His Excellency Anthony Thomas Aquinas, OLTDSC. The Salary Review Commission, at the time of approval, was appointed by His Excellency the fourth president, Professor George Maxwell Richards, OLTD. Any allegation of complicity with myself as it relates to the approval of the housing allowance is totally without merit and even defamatory. The bottom line is, because of the woefully inadequate furnishings, both my wife and I attempted to fill the aforementioned lacuna by using our personal furnishings in the said house. As I indicated earlier on, there was leakage in the living room, the small room, and the master bedroom. I even lost files and books in that three-bedroom house with a very small study. I quietly repaired leaks at my personal expense. And you know what, ladies and gentlemen? The entire household staff that were there with us at Flagstaff can attest to my veracity on the conditions under which we were. Yes. Veracity. His Excellency the President, as head of state, I continue to rent my previous apartment to the tune of some $12,000 per month with other utilities expenses. And in the 2 months, the 2 years I spent at Flagstaff Villas, out of my pocket, I spent in rent monies to the tune of $300,000. That money has never been reimbursed. I've never been reimbursed for it, and I've never asked for reimbursement. The head of state, the president of this great republic, was forced to store government property and his personal property at a rented place. Since Norsley was no longer available and the Flagstaff House had no storage space. Additionally, all the cooking for state functions were in the main done at our personal rented apartment at great personal expense. Again, the entire household staff can attest to these unsatisfactory conditions. In short, using the president's official residence, the Great House, as the standard, the Flagstaff resident was not and could not be considered suitable alternative accommodation. I did not make the decision, nor did I coerce, suggest, authorize, or impose that decision of the Salaries Review Commission. It was made by an independent Salaries Review Commission, together with its secretary, the Chief Personnel Officer, who by letter dated 7th of July 2013 informed me that I would receive the allowance during that period I occupied such temporary accommodation. My family and I finally moved into the cottage at the end of May 2015. Even though the cottage is not the official residence of the president, it is rather the president's house. The cottage is there to accommodate the president's guests and visiting dignitaries. When I moved to the president's cottage, it was in the public domain, and I made sure that it was stated that we had stopped receiving the $28,000 allowance since May of last year. This was never ventilated. It was kept down, and we were pillared. Moving into the presidential cottage, I immediately instructed the accounting department to stop payment of the said house housing allowance effective May 21st, 2016. So again, I need to repeat that in fact, I no longer have access to that housing allowance, and that has been the case since May 21st, 2016. No, 2015, sorry. 20. Meeting with the Honorable Minister of National Security. On the 5th of September 2016, I met with the Honorable Minister of National Security, the Chief of Defence Staff, and the Acting Commissioner of Police. Present at that said meeting was my aide-de-camp and my senior legal officer. The meeting was conducted with the stated support of the Honorable Prime Minister, Dr. Kikau. I wish to emphatically state that I have always been compliant with the doctrine of separation of powers, and I am more than aware of my constitutional remit with respect to the other branches of the executive, and indeed of the government. It is exactly for that reason that on three occasions beforehand, I indicated to the Honorable Prime Minister my intention to hold a meeting with the Minister of National Security in the interest of offering suggestions on certain pertinent issues in this republic, and he supported it. At the onset of the meeting, I mentioned the Prime Minister's support, and that was confirmed by those present. I wish to make it clear now, as I did then at the said meeting, that I did not impose myself or my views on those great men, on the cabinet, or on the Honorable Prime Minister. Nor did I unlawfully interfere with the exercise of the functions of the Prime Minister or members of the cabinet. I did not, as reported, summon them to a meeting. And anyone who knows me, who genuinely knows me, and see how I operate, I do not engage in that leadership style. I am about service leadership. There were no demands made of the Honorable Minister with respect to time. We worked around his time. The matters discussed with those present at the meeting, with the support of the PM, were merely suggestions and possible solutions that were offered for consideration in my capacity as head of state and commander-in-chief of the armed forces. It is to be noted that much has been said about the alleged constitutional impropriety of my holding such a meeting, without emphasis to the purpose of the said meeting. I am a citizen of this country, and like every other citizen of this republic, I can legitimately offer suggestions within my constitutional remit to alleviate certain issues that plague us as a nation. As President of the Republic, I acted within the remit of the Constitution by virtues of Section 74, 80, and 81. This meeting was conducted with reference to the Honorable Prime Minister because I had his support to hold a meeting. I even went so far as setting out the contents and discussions comprehensively of that said meeting to the Honorable Prime Minister by way of a voluminous letter, a private and confidential missive with appended documents, which was delivered the day following the meeting. This entire meeting was conducted in the strictest confidentiality and with the highest respect and regard for the institution of government, the separation of powers, and, if I may in fact engage, according to Montesquieu, with regard to the Westminster form of government, the philosophy of the interdependence of powers. I, nor the office of the President, disclosed to anyone, especially the media, the contents of that meeting in keeping with my strict adherence to presidential confidentiality and protocol. The only persons who are aware of the contents of that meeting were those present and the Prime Minister, the Honorable Dr. Keith C. Rowley, Prime Minister of Philanthropy. I am therefore extremely concerned that that missive which was sent to the Honorable Prime Minister under strictest and private confidentiality have found itself in the hands of the press. I am even more taken aback to have received a letter from the Honorable Prime Minister which calls into question the constitutional propriety of my holding the said meeting, especially since I had his support to conduct sale. Perhaps the explanation for the oversight may well be found in the fact that the Honorable Prime Minister has a vast portfolio of responsibilities and a hectic schedule, and quite possibly may have forgotten our discussions and his stated support which he gave to me to hold the said meeting. I can assure you, ladies and gentlemen, that when the Honorable Prime Minister and I meet, the discussions are very extensive, very comprehensive, very deep. I am not in the business of shaking hands and engaging in simple courtesies. I am engaged in holding hands so that in fact we all here can move forward with the required vision to make this country a greater place. The legal opinion which was provided to the Honorable Prime Minister in respect of the said meeting answered interior the question whether it was constitutionally proper for the President to arrange a meeting with a member of the Cabinet without reference to the Prime Minister or at all. I clarify for the public benefit that a meeting was conducted with reference to the Prime Minister. The support was given. I was given on three occasions to go ahead with the meeting. I also clarify, and I wish to state, that I acted within my constitutional remit in holding the meeting. Reference having been made to the Honorable Prime Minister. There is nothing in the Constitution or otherwise that prohibits such a meeting. The contents and the discussions of the said meeting shall remain confidential on the part of the Office of the President and shall remain protected information having regard to its intended purpose in the first place and the integrity with which it is shared with those present, with the requisite support. Much has been stated about the execution of my duties and responsibilities as President, and especially the Auditor General's report. But in my humble opinion, not enough. Again, I can assure you, if you read every single line in the auditor's report for the financial year 2015, every single line, ladies and gentlemen, it will be both an experience and a revelation. I am all for transparency, accountability, and integrity, but it cannot be selective. It cannot be transient. It cannot be convenient. And it must not be misdirected in the face of proper action. I have always sought to serve in this high office in a dignified and uplifting ways which can help exalt the nation. If I have stumbled in any way, and yes, the runner stumbles on the race of life. And if I have stumbled in any way, I ask your forgiveness. And where possible, your good advice. If sometimes I have come across as too passionate, it is because I cannot be deadpan on suggesting ways and means that we can become a better and greater nation. I am passionate. I am passionate about this country, and I make no apologies about it, because I firmly believe that this country of ours, notwithstanding the pitfalls, the trials, afflictions, and tribulations we encounter, that we are a great nation in the eyes of the world. Thank you very much.